us is we are responsible for collecting the community district need statements and community board budget requests. Those are two charter mandated tasks that community boards have to do every year. And another big part of our work is that we provide information to community boards that touch on everything that city planning is doing, land use, zoning, and of course also the community district needs statements and budget requests. And I'm here today to give you a short overview of the tools we're making available to you. I'm also interested in hearing from you what maybe is missing, what you would find useful that we could provide for you to make your work easier. So as Aldrin said, a very important piece of the information that we provide is for you, for the boards to allow you to prepare the CD needs and community board budget requests every year. But I want to take a little bit broader approach and show you some of the tools that you might find useful for other tasks that community boards are tasked with as well. First, I will give you a short overview of the goals of this evening's presentation, and then I will give you a walkthrough of the different tools that we have to offer, and obviously feel free to ask questions along the way if something is unclear. Okay, so here's the agenda for today. As I mentioned before, first, we will talk a little bit about the context of those tools that I will present to you today, and then I want to highlight three tools in particular that might be useful for you. There's a lot of information on the Department of City Planning website, and I invite you to check it out. But those three tools, the community portal Zola, which is a mapping application, and the New York City Census Fact Finder, might be of particular value for you, and then we will have a Q&A at the end. Does that all make sense? Okay, so the tools I'm presenting to you tonight are meant to support the three main functions that a community board is tasked to do. The first one is community boards have a role in land use applications, and as part of the city's land use review process, they can make recommendations with regard to land use applications. The second important task that community boards have, and you all know that, is that they regularly connect with agencies about service delivery in their district. And the third big thing that community boards do is they participate in the city's budget process. And this is where the community district need statements and the community board budget requests come into play. And as I said before, I'm also looking tonight to you for some feedback on what tools you think are missing on our website and information that we might be able to provide. Aldrin? We have a little technical glitch here. My screen is further ahead than this one. Yeah.
While you're waiting, are those tools available to all community board members or only the district manager?
What I'll be talking about tonight is available to the general public.
Good.
But obviously when we designed those tools, we had the community boards in mind. But it's generally available information. Do I have to use the clicker?
No, I think we could do this way, like this, right?
Yeah, okay.
Why doesn't? Shoot, what? It doesn't?
It happens.
Okay.
This is
wonderful. Let me...
Try clicking on the next slide on that one. Oh, there we go. Okay.
Yeah, so you see, that's, you could hit right down, down and up. Down and up.
Okay, when I do up and down, it works, and when I do left and right.
Yes, okay. Left and up goes back. Okay. Down and right goes
to
the next slide.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, you took the first hurdle. Let's go right into this. So as I said, there's three big tasks that community boards perform. One is the review of land use applications. They talk to the city about local service delivery to make sure that in a city of 8.5 million people, everyone gets the sanitation services and so on that they need. And as I mentioned, they participate in the city's budget process. So, as part of the land use review, community boards are part of the EULA process. So once the City Planning Commission decides that an application is complete, it gets first sent to the community boards, and the community boards can give a recommendation on that specific land use application. This is for projects, private and public, that are happening in the respective community district. So you will see all applications that go through ULURP that affect your district. And examples for that include, for example, a change of the zoning, both zoning map change and zoning text change, certain special permits. If the city is selling property in your district, that would be a ULURP action. And if the city plans to site a new facility, such as a precinct house or something like that in your district, that would be part of the public review process. And also, city planning reaches out to community boards and other community-based organizations when we are doing a area-wide rezoning of an area. And in most instances, actually, it's the community boards that approach city planning and say, look, the zoning in our district doesn't work for us. You have to do something, and we work with community boards. The next thing that community boards are tasked to do is they meet regularly with the service chiefs of city agencies. So once a month or so, there's something called the district service cabinet meeting. And this is when the district manager meets with the local police precinct commander, the sanitation chief, and so on, and they talk about everyday issues that need to be addressed. For example, the trash in street X doesn't get picked up, do something about that. As I said, this is a regular occurrence, and the idea is that city agencies and the community stay in close contact and address those everyday problems as soon as possible. If there are bigger problems or issues to discuss, then it becomes a matter of the city's of the community board's involvement in the city's budget process. So as part of the city's budget process, the community boards are involved in two ways. The first one is the statement of community district needs. The idea behind that is that communities tell the city what are the issues in our district and what should the city do to address those issues. And obviously the idea is that you, the community, know best what's going on in your community, and you have the best view of the problems there and how they can be fixed. And this really affects or relates to all aspects of what's going on in your community, healthcare and human services, that includes, for example, facilities for seniors, youth and education, public safety, housing and economic development, but also, of course, parks and community facilities, city services such as sanitation, water, sewage, and so on. and so on. So that's the first way communities are involved in the budget process, is by telling us what does the community need. In addition to that, the community can also submit budget requests to city agencies. And those budget requests are more specific than the general needs. The general needs might say, we have a lot of crime in our community and we need more cops to address that. And in the community board budget requests, community boards can make a specific request for something. Like, the comfort station in park so-and-so is in disrepair, please fix that comfort station. It does not mean that the city will necessarily do that right away. Obviously, budgeting is complicated and funds are limited, but it's a unique opportunity for communities to give their input on what the city should do. And those two things, the statement of community district needs and the community board budget request, are actually at the very beginning of the city's budget process. The idea being that the communities tell the city what the city should do, and the agencies should consider the community input when they make their own budgets. And that information then gets rolled up into the departmental budget plans and eventually in the city's overall budget plan. So once again, it's a very important role that communities have and community boards have in the city's budget process. Okay, so far any questions?
When does the budget process start for the city?
Sorry?
When, what month more or less start the budget planning for the
city? I mean, it's pretty much a continuous process. So the city's budget year, the fiscal year, starts on July 1st. So we're now approaching fiscal year 2017. On July 1st, we will have fiscal year 2017. But we are actually already preparing the budget for fiscal year 2018. So we will be rolling out, there's an electronic form to collect the statement of community district needs and the community board budget requests. And we are preparing to roll out that form for fiscal year 2018. So it's a year-long process that's sort of continues after the budget is before the budget. Yeah?
So is city planning the vetting agency for this? Like, you guys collect from all the community boards and then you distribute to the Parks Department and the Police Department? How does it actually work?
We are working with OMB, the Office of Management and Budget. So city planning, we own the form and we collect the information, and OMB's task is they check the requests to make sure that the right requests are going to the right agency, and they distribute it to the city agencies, and the city agencies are actually required to respond to those requests. So at the beginning of each year, calendar year, in January, there's the preliminary budget plan, and OMB then publishes a register of budget request that has the agency response to all community board budget requests. Last year there were 3,302 budget requests from all 59 community boards.
How does that relate to the mayor's office? Where is the mayor?
OMB is part of the mayor's office. Yeah. There were questions back there. Yeah?
So then, in regard to the first function, the community board signed off on the sale of Rivington House?
Mm-hmm. Okay. I mean, I'm not familiar with the...
That's the question?
No, they didn't.
Sorry, no.
As part of the process, the application, if it was a ULURP application, I'm not familiar with that particular application. Okay. But if it's a ULURP application, the application goes to the community board, and the community board can make a recommendation.
Okay. So if it's a ULURP process.
If it's a ULURP application, there's a couple of land use actions that might not be subject to ULURP. So I'm not familiar with that particular application. Yeah?
How can current community members make proposals to present to the community board? Because you mentioned the electronic forum that's launching in 2018, but how is that currently addressed? Like, let's say there's a community member that has a proposal for something to put it in the community that they want to present to the community board.
That is really up to the community boards and the rules, the community boards and the bylaws the community boards have have established. So city planning is not part of that.
Okay.
So you would have to talk to your district manager, to committee chair, if there is a budget request that you want to make or a community board member wants to make, it would have to be filtered through the community board, but we as city planning, we're not involved in how community boards organize themselves and how they structure their work internally. Are there any other questions before we move on? Yeah?
So this relates to the district needs and budget process.
Mm-hmm.
The city planning didn't used to be the agency that community boards submitted information to. It used to just be OMB, is that correct?
Yes.
The budget requests, yes. The district needs statements always went to city planning. And then we collected them, we sent them to OMB, OMB distributed them to the agencies. What we tried to do was, together with OMB, so OMB is very much part of this process, is that obviously the needs should inform the requests. And what we wanted to do is create a stronger connection between the two. The needs is sort of the explanation or the rationale for your requests. The need is, the issue is you have crime in your community. The need is you need more policing, or maybe you need more social programs. And then based on this analysis of needs, you make a request. We need more after-school programs to address youth crime, or we need more cops in the street to do that. So that's the reason why we worked with OMB to combine those two processes. Yeah?
What is OMB?
The Office of Management and Budget. So that's a part of the mayor's office. Any other questions? Okay. So now let's take a closer look on the tools I want to talk about in more detail tonight. And once again, the city planning website is full of information, but those are three very important tools that can help you both with the city needs statements and budget requests, but also with other aspects of a community board's work. The first one I want to talk about is there's a whole section that's called Communities on the Department of City Planning website that has two parts, the community portal, which provides data for specific community districts. So for all 59 community districts in New York City, there's specific district-specific data there. And then there's also a section about community planning that is more about processes that communities are involved in or that they can use. The next tool I want to talk about is Zola. That is a mapping application that shows a wealth of information about zoning and land use in New York City. And that is very useful for reviewing land use applications that come to community boards. And third, the Census Fact Finder provides demographic information for New York City. And of course, that is also very useful for you. When you think about, for example, the needs of seniors in your community, the first question is, how many seniors do you have? Do you maybe have more seniors relative to other community districts? Or do you have a lot of school-aged children? So this is all demographic information that you can find out from Census Fact Finder. And we will walk through all three of those tools. So the first thing I want to talk about is the community portal. and communities. So as I said, it has two sections, the community portal itself, and then the second tab that you can see up here, community planning, that is more about processes that the community is involved in. And the difference really between the two of them is that the community portal has more data and information that is specific to each community district. And as I said, community planning is more about processes that communities can be involved in. So that's community planning. To get there, you can go to the Department of City Planning website, and you can click the Communities tab. The link is here. We will make this presentation available so you can use that as a reference. In order to access the community portal, you click the community portal button. And then in order to get information for your specific community district, you just go to the map that you see at the bottom and select your community district from that map. Once you've selected your community district, you will find information about your district that is organized in four different tabs. The first tab is the district profile. And the district profile is really a snapshot of what's going on in your district. So how many people live there? What's overall the land use in your district? Some vital statistics and so on. The second tab deals with projects and resources. So here you can find information, for example, if the Department of City Planning is doing a land use study in your district, there would be information about that. But this is also the place where you can access your community district needs statement, but where you can also find information about active and completed land use applications that happened in your district. The third tab that you can find on the community portal page deals with population data. So on this page, you find for your district information about demographics, age, race, and so on, but also about housing, how many households are rent burdened, for example, how many housing units are there, social indicators, what is the median income, and so on. So there's a wealth of information about different demographic facets of your community. And the last tab provides some mapping resources that are available to you. Obviously, there's a lot of online tools. The maps that are provided here in this particular section, those are ready-made PDF maps that are easy to print out and that you can use for your discussions at the board. And let me just show you a couple of things here. So once again, our website is nyc.gov/planning. And you can access the community portal by clicking the communities button here. And then at the default is that it opens to the community portal. And so if your Flash player isn't updated, you can't access the map. But you can also select your neighborhood through that drop-down menu here. So not to offend anyone, we're going to Brooklyn. And let's just find a neighborhood. what's nice, Red Hook. And that then gets you to the district profile page. Yeah?
Are you trying to display something different from that?
What? Oh. So we have the same problem again with the...
Maybe minimize this one.
I don't think it's that.
Oh,
wait,
there you go.
Oh. Ah, here we go. So, of course, now you haven't seen the whole thing. Let's go back. So, you go to our website. You click communities. The default is the community portal. Once again, if you had your Flash Player updated, you could select your district on the map. But if that doesn't work, you can also select your neighborhood through that drop-down menu here. And then it brings you to your district's profile. And as I said before, the first thing that you will see is the district profile. It has some very basic information. The idea really here is to give you a snapshot of what's going on in your district and where it's located. And you can switch between those different tabs up here. And the next section you will find here is about projects and resources going on in your district. So for example, in Red Hook, in Brooklyn Commune District 6, DCP is doing a study, and there was a 197A plan that the community did a couple of years ago. So you can access that information and additional information about that those plans here. And what I said before, when you get to review land use projects that are subject to ULURP, you can find information about those individual projects by clicking here. And it then gives you a list of all those projects going on in your specific district with the status of those projects. So you see here the active projects, but you can also access, it's probably also a flash problem here, you can also access older projects as well. Yeah, it seems to be a flash.
Are these only ULURP projects or more?
Those are only ULURP projects, yeah, because city planning is not involved in the review of as-of-right projects. So the only thing that we see are ULURP projects.
What about special permits?
If it's a special permit through the City Planning Commission, then it would be here. If it's a BSA special permit, BSA. It would be on the BSA website. Yeah. Yeah?
So the work or the conversations around being transparent about lifting deed restrictions, would that come through city planning, do you think?
Deed restrictions... I mean, that's really... it's a DCAS issue. If that action goes through city planning, you would find information here.
And so you're talking about making a database or just providing more information about properties that have a deed restriction attached to them. I mean, is there any conversation whether that would go through you, or is that still in the early conversation?
It would probably be, there's also different kinds of deed restrictions. So there's deed restrictions on city property. So DCAS would know about those. But there's also a number of deed restrictions on private properties. I would have to check where there would be, if there is a central repository for all those.
That's something that will be very helpful. We had a check on something. It's almost impossible.
Yeah.
It's really old to get any information.
Yeah. There is
some of it's really old.
Yeah. On I know that on the zoning map, there is sometimes little R's that indicate restrictive declarations that are a type of deed restrictions. And in the zoning resolution, there's an appendix that lists all those restrictive declarations.
And that's on the zoning map?
Yeah. So that is something, it might not work because Flash doesn't work. Yeah, maybe let's try that. So unfortunately, those little R's are very small. So it's not easy to find. But there are some deed restrictions are on there. A lot of them relate to environmental review issues. So,
can you give an example of the environmental?
For every ULURP application or every discretionary action that the city takes, there has to be an environmental review. And as part of the environmental review, it could say that if a particular building gets torn down, they have to test the soil for hazardous material. So what city planning would do, they put a little E on the map that's then is referenced in an index in the zoning resolution that says for this particular property block so-and-so, lot so-and-so, there has to be it has to be tested for hazardous materials in the soil. The idea being that if you rezone something and there sits a building on it, then you can't test the soil. But once you want to redevelop that property, you have to make sure that there are no contaminants in the soil.
And that would be something that would have a designated R for
That would have an E for an environmental designation. There's also, in some instances, there's R's for other restrictions. Such a restriction could be that only community facility uses are allowed on that particular property, even though the zoning would allow for other uses as well. But I don't think there's a comprehensive repository for
but
all those things. Some of them.
Some
of them, not all of them.
Yep.
And I understand a lot of the city deed restrictions are not on there. Any other
questions?
Yeah?
If something's going through ULURP, can you, on this website, find out when the various hearings are? Is it the presentations, is it the public presentations and hearings?
What the Lucats, what I showed you, is it shows you the phase that the project is in. Public hearings have to be posted in the city record.
So how do you find out, like, if you're, say, curious about the project, progress of a resiliency project, and how would you...
I mean, a lot of the things for DCP projects, they would have on the project website something, public meeting upcoming, but that would be independent of the ULURP status of that. What you can find on the DCP website is information about DCP hearings, public hearings as part of the ULURP process that would be posted.
So
on the website,
like zoning or something that's DCP related.
If it's so, let me show you this first. So this here shows you the latest commission meetings and commission hearings and the agenda for those hearings.
I just want to say that you were all emailed the PowerPoint presentation. So you don't have to really take so much notes if you want. The PowerPoint presentation is in your inbox already.
Thank you.
The other thing is that for if there is active plans going on, it might not even be in ULURP yet. There might be public hearings, and then you would go to the specific project website. And if there is a public hearing, you could sign up, or a public meeting, you could sign up and you would get notified about those things. Yeah?
Is DCP or someone else responsible for telling the community board when a proposed zoning change has been made, for example?
I mean, what happens is that once an application is certified, it gets sent the next day to the community board with a notification, this is the application is now complete, here is it for your review, and you have 60 days to review that, and your recommendation is due by that date. It's then the community board's responsibility to schedule a public hearing for that particular, or put that application on the agenda of a public hearing. So what city planning does is we send it out as soon as it's certified, and certification means it's complete for public review. And as I said before, for a lot of the DCP projects, there's a lot of outreach that's already happening before certification, but that's not part of the ULURP process. And then we also give the community boards forms where they then put in their recommendation on a specific project. Any other questions?
I just want to say, because you was asking for suggestions too, on some of the more complex projects, if you can get to the community board even before it's certified, and it's much better, because sometimes the community board has to reach out to different community groups, get input from it, so the earlier we know about it, it really is very helpful, because that 60 days goes very fast once it's certified. If you just had a land use meeting or just had a zoning committee meeting, you may have to wait a month before you have another scheduled meeting.
Yeah.
So and if city planning can start letting people know, and the projects aren't planned in 60 days, the way before, it's very helpful. I know Gail's office, this office, tries to let us know as early as possible.
Yeah. And so one thing for DCP projects, we usually try to reach out as soon as possible. For private applications, the problem is that before it's certified, it's not really ready for review because there might be important pieces of information missing. What you can see, however, in LUCATS, I believe, is when a project is filed. So you might get some early warning there is something coming down the pike that might be certified. The problem is that filing doesn't necessarily tell you, oh, this is something that comes along in the next 5 weeks. Sometimes there's multiple versions filed, and it can go on for years. But the problem with that is that certification means an application is ready for public review. It has all the information in there that the public needs to make an informed decision about that particular project.
I think in terms of communications, this came up as one of the landmarks one, when some community board members were like, well, I've never received the landmarks list, or when things are calendared or whatnot. Mm-hmm. And I believe when you mean that it's communicated to the community board, you mean that it's communicated to the district manager.
Yes, okay. Yeah.
So you guys got to understand the role that the district manager plays in all of this and reach out to him or her. Or they should be reaching out to you, but when they mean that it's being communicated to the community board, that's what they're referring to, that the agency is communicating with the district manager. Mm-hmm. That came up a lot during the landmarks and during the budgeting workshop, mm-hmm. and now I guess during the DCP.
And of course the other important source is the city record, and every public hearing needs to be published in the city record a certain number of days in advance. Of that public hearing, that is a legal requirement. So you find a lot of information about stuff that's going on there as well.
I think the joke is, if you want to absolutely make sure nobody knows what the hell's going on,
put it in the city record.
The city record.
That's right.
I don't know how many of you.
I don't think we read it every day.
Is there an electronic version?
Yes, absolutely. Yes. Yeah. So that's all available electronically, but obviously first you have to know that such a thing exists.
But I don't think it pushes stuff out.
No.
So I don't think you could go on the city record and say, give me all things CB8,
no.
And then automatically it pushes it out. So
no.
I think that's one of the critiques of it.
Cool.
Yeah, but I don't think it doesn't do that for
me. Yeah.
Couldn't you go to
my dates and it's downloaded?
Yeah.
Couldn't you also go to Google and type in the site code and then the term for specific community board to search the site?
You can, but then you end up with the entire edition
of
the city record. You don't end up with, it doesn't pinpoint for you.
Yeah, no.
So there's obviously a paper version because city government likes paper. But there's also an electronic version of that as well. And honestly, I have to tell you what Aldrin just mentioned. I look almost never at the city record. It's just that things that the City Planning Commission, they have to publish the agenda there, but it's also published on our website, so if I want to know about a project, I look on the City Planning website.
There's a huge issue, because I think someone mentioned Rivington and the deed restriction being lifted and all that, and I believe while no one knew, but I think there was an appearance just ever so slightly on the city record. So I guess that part of it was done, but it's a good point.
How often does a new one come out?
Once again, I have. It might actually be daily. So
I think it's daily.
Yeah.
I think it's
so
daily.
So it gets up. It's not that it's like published on January 1st for the whole year, because there's constantly city agencies have hearings, and it's not only land use stuff. It's also other legal hearings that are going on. And it's also what makes it so convoluted is that it's not just like 10 things that the City Planning Commission has on their agenda. There's a whole slew of public hearings that are constantly going on, and obviously that no one cares about, unless obviously you're affected by that particular public hearing. But it gets updated constantly. So, going back to the...
Do you have a question?
Oh, sorry.
I kind of think it's from you. When you were saying that ultimately the information is with the district manager that we may be looking for, so how do we do the checks and balances with the district manager to know that we're either receiving the information or even that they're receiving it? You know what I'm saying? Like, how do we effectively do our jobs in the area?
And I think that's a great question. I think that's a question. There's 12 community boards, and what I've learned about Manhattan's 12 community boards, Many of them are islands unto themselves, so I don't pretend to give you an answer to all 12, but that's something, that's a fair question. It's a fair question that community board members, as being appointees as, in that body, you have a right to ask that question either on committee or to the CME chair or to the district manager. I think that's a, the whole question of communications and handling the information is one that I think all 12 CBs are probably long overdue, especially every time you get new members. Right? I think that's the first question that you need to take up within your community board.
And the district manager works for the community board members. They hire the district manager.
Right. I don't want to get too far from you. Yeah. I know you have much content to come.
Thank you.
Yeah, so obviously that's a very important question, but it's also how the community boards organize themselves and how you hold your community board leadership accountable for certain things. The other thing that I would like to highlight here in the resources section is the community district needs statements. So once the form is submitted by the boards, there's a report created that you can access here, and this is what a community district needs statements looks like. So it has the needs and budget requests based on 7 policy areas that range from healthcare and human services to transportation and to parks. City planning, the thing we do is we compile it. We don't change any of the wording there.
Can you give an example of that?
So, for example, every community district needs statement has a narrative, so they identify, for example, for healthcare and human services, they identify a main issue that they have and then provide an explanation and describe the needs that the district has with regard to healthcare facilities and healthcare overall. So you can check it out. We have it for 55, sorry? No, it doesn't work. I'm sorry about that. I'm not quite sure what I'm doing here or not doing, but. Let's close this. So here we go. This is an example. So this is available for every community district in the resources section. You go here. If the community board submitted one, there's a couple of community boards that choose not to submit one, none in Manhattan.
We wouldn't dare not to.
But this is what they look like, and they have a statement. They have basically a chapter on healthcare, on transportation, on land use and zoning, and so on. So I invite you to have a look at your district's needs statement and check it out. Yeah.
I just joined the community board, but I was reading the one for my community board. Mm-hmm. Is that drafted from scratch, or is this like a template that's built in?
I mean,
Are the categories there already?
The categories are there, but obviously the content is provided by the community board. And one thing that we did as part of what Aldrin mentioned before was we tried to structure it a little bit more better. So that it's more comparable between community boards. One thing that we could also do for the first time with this new process, because it's now everything is online, we can see how many community districts requested, for example, a new park. That was something we could not do easily, at least in years past. But because we now have it more systematized, that it's now something that we can do. We also ask community boards for their main issues, and that's also very interesting to see how the main issues for the borough of Manhattan are different from other boroughs, for example. This is also information that we didn't have before. This is very much a work in progress. So we rolled out the new process last year. We got an earful from your colleagues, and we're working with you and with the district managers to improve that the product in the future, so that it works for everyone involved, the agencies, you, the community boards, and city planning for like larger planning purposes. Yeah.
Can you go back and get like statement of needs from 2015, 14?
Not at the moment. What we're working on is, so we have them back to like 1980-something, but those were paper copies. So what we did was we scanned them all, but now some poor summer intern has to cut them into pieces. So there is like 30 years times 59 district need statements that need to be chopped into pieces. But we're working on that, and the idea is that we would have an archive of CD need statements available in hopefully the not so far future. It's probably going to happen in phases, so that the most recent ones are available sooner than the really classic vintage CD need statements. Yeah?
So is the poor intern going to try to take apart the old district needs statements that were more narrative and less fill in the blanks than your model and try to fit what used to
no.
be there into the
no.
thank God.
It's just being chopped up. So I'm not sure if anyone remembers the paper version. It was basically a book for every borough.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And what we do, so they were scanned, but what we now need to do is basically chop the Manhattan book into 12 pieces for every year. That's the only thing we're doing, so that it's easily accessible for search purposes. Yeah.
I'm sorry. Can you again just show us how you got to it? Was it in the portal?
Yeah. So you go to the portal. You select your district. And then it's in the Projects and Resources tab, and then it's here, the Statement of Community District Needs. The other thing that I wanted to mention is population data. So in this section, you find demographic information specific to your district by PUMA, which is the approximation of a community district in census terms, and by NTA, which are sub-areas of a community district. So obviously there's this 59 community districts, but there's, I think, about 180 NTAs. So those are sub-areas of community districts. And obviously, some community districts are very big, and one half of the community district can be very different from the other, so NTAs allow you a more detailed view of what's going on in a community district. Yes?
How current is the population data?
This one here for the Pumas is, I think this is... this. The census data is from 2010, but this data here is from the American Community Survey, and this is from 2010 to 2012. On the Census Fact Finder, there's more up-to-date data than that. But so all this data that you see here, the demographic information, is all from the Census Bureau. So it's either census data directly or American Community Survey. And what our population division at City Planning does is they make it usable for New York City geography. So the Census Bureau in Washington, D.C. does not know what a community district is. So what our population division does is they collect the data and make it available on a community district level. But obviously all the data, there's a certain time lag. So if it's right. 1 or 2 years old, it's actually pretty good for that kind of data. So it first goes to Washington, then it comes to our population division, and they then prepare it for use here on the community portal or the census fact finder.
Okay.
who here took the census training? So you saw, like, in the census website, they've done a lot of advances because they've integrated the census data with a GIS system. So you can actually draw your own boundaries. You can they've overlaid it around community boards a lot nicer now. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Their new iteration in the Census Bureau one. So a lot of people, we're going to try to get them back to do another training because it was really useful for people, especially to be able to. You never were able to draw your own maps before, as granular as, you know, different block levels, and now you can do that on the Census website. Mm-hmm. The city planning, what they did was they did that as well. Overlaying how we understand community districts to be, because as you mentioned, the Census Bureau for them, their geography terminology is more like census block, census track. They don't do things on the neighborhood level. So for many years, graduate students and demographers and statisticians would just go around and say, okay, this is what the neighborhood is, and then they would just draw the different tracks to get that kind of aggregate number. But a lot of that work's been done already for you by the Department of City Planning, but in the last year, the census has also done that work. And they've done it more so, where they said, okay, not only is it for the district, community district, but you can draw, using this kind of little lasso thing, around any kind of district you want, and then automatically populate what's the poverty rate, what's the vacancy rate, what's the percent, you know, ethnicity, gender, anything you could possibly imagine, health insurance. It was just, those of you who were here saw the number of variables.
Yeah. And some of this is also available on the city planning website, and we'll talk about this a little bit later. The last tab that I wanted to mention here is also there's a couple of ready-made maps for you. You can also see online versions of those maps, but those maps here are usually better for printing. So, for example, one map that we have here is a land use map. That might come in handy when you discuss zoning, for example, or you can also download a base map of your district that's basically just a map with the streets that you can use for planning purposes. Any questions with regards to the community portal? Yeah?
One stop. The program, the planning program is presented. I find here it's done for 2017. So I guess this year will be 2018. Can they go back, because it says preliminary, can they go back and change, or they have to move forward with the ideas in 2018? Planning proposal.
The planning proposals, they go back. You can also see old projects on there. So it goes back. They have the city planning. So once the Euler project goes through the whole land use review process, the end of it is there's a report by the city planning commission. It's sort of the official document of the decision, the record of decision from the City Planning Commission. And we have the City Planning Commission reports going back to 1938 when the City Planning Commission was created. So if you're interested in finding out a project that was done in the mid-90s and what the conditions were that the City Planning Commission put on that, you can find those reports on the website.
What happened once it's proposed? Is it get approved? Who has the last decision? Because it's a lot of work here, as I see.
Yeah.
But does anything happen with this information?
I think
more or less work on this, because this is definitely happening.
Yeah, I mean, I think that you have another session about ULURP, correct? Yeah, so that's a question that should be asked at that session. But in the ULURP process, the community boards, the borough presidents, the city planning commission, and the city council are involved. But as I said, there's a separate training.
There's two zoning workshops.
Yeah, yeah. So if you're interested in that, you should visit those sessions. Yeah.
Can you talk more about how the money works? Is there a certain allocation per community board, or per, like, is each, the community boards are competing with the other communities? Or is there a specified amount of money? And how is the allocation?
You mean as part of the budget process?
Yeah.
That's not how it works. It's basically the requests are sent to the agencies. And the agencies then review those requests and approve them, or think they are a good idea, or don't think they are a good idea. But there's not a pot of money that gets distributed per community district.
I just have to say, as a former chair of the board way back 100 years ago, and as chair of the budget committee, it's gotten more frustrating every year. I know we're only advisory, but we get back things from now City Plan, but also OMB and the agencies that said, that's great, we really agree with that. If there's money in the budget, we'll do it. But we're asking money to go into the budget. That makes absolutely no sense. And then people don't even want to participate in the process because you get those really ridiculous
absolutely
answers. It makes no sense to say if there's money in the budget. We're asking the mayor to put it back in the budget. That's what we're doing.
And that is part of the reason why we started looking at this process, because we heard that frustration from community boards. We also heard a lot of frustration from the agency, so we're trying to fix it, but it'll take.
It hasn't gotten better.
Maybe.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Is there a tool yet that looks back retroactively on what was delivered by the agencies to these requests or the percentages? I take it no.
I mean, there is now already in the budget register, there's a very crude tool that tells you how many requests were approved, I think, by community board. And the budget registers, they are produced every year. So you can, in theory, go back and sort of draw up. But there's no ready-made tool that tells you, oh, Community District 5 in Manhattan, in the last couple of years, this is how the approval rate changed, or something like that. But this is potentially something that with the new form would be something that we can produce or might be able to produce. And so there's a lot of issues with the process right now, and one, as you mentioned, is the responses that agencies give to community board budget requests. They're not great. So we're working on that as well. So in many instances, one big frustration for community boards is that they don't know, is it a yes or a no, or is it a maybe, and this is something that we need to do more work on, and obviously you as a community board who makes the request, the least what you should get is an honest answer of what's going on. So as I said, it's a work in progress. Was there another question?
Someone sort of answered it. I wasn't sure how the process worked. If the community is requesting, you know, they're saying that this is the statement of what the budget needs are for this community, and it goes to the agencies, and the agencies say, yeah, great idea, but we don't have the money. Mm-hmm. Is that, am I paraphrasing that right?
Yes. I mean, in some instances, the agencies also say, yes, it's a great idea, and we pay for it. There's a couple of things that are happening here, that there is also, it's not quite easy for anyone to understand how different things are connected. So for example, one community board asked for more trash cans at the intersection of blah 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 street and blah 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 avenue. The way the agency looks at it is not at trash cans at the intersection of those two streets. There is a line in the budget that says trash cans for streets in New York City. So the agency then considers it as funded because there's a budget line for it. And what one thing that we're trying to do is creating that feedback loop that community boards can see what happens to their request in the budget process. And that's very difficult to achieve, but that's something that we're trying to work on. Yeah?
It seems like there could be a number of requests like that are mm-hmm. funded, but that the request is some sort of specific implementation.
Yeah.
So how does the board or the city follow up on implementing something that's already funded?
I mean, if it's funded, then there's money allocated. That's the easiest case.
They'll tell you that.
The difficult piece is that it's not always quite clear what gets funded. So there is no budget line for fixing the pothole on this particular street. Mm-hmm. There is a budget line for fixing all the potholes in New York City. And this is then where it becomes very tricky because DOT tells you, last year we fixed tens of thousands of potholes throughout New York City, and they did that, but they did not fix that pothole that the community board requested to have fixed, even though it then says that the request was funded because there was a budget line for fixing that.
So I guess my question is there a status besides funded that refers to, acted upon? Because in those cases, funding is not enough to actually
mm-hmm.
meet the request.
Mm-hmm. There is other documents that are available to community boards. There's something called the District Resource Statement that is published by a number of agencies that specifies by district what the agency has done in a certain district. And obviously, this is also where the communications with the district service cabinet meetings come into play, where the community boards can ask the agencies that provide services, like, what's going on? The pothole is still there. I read in the budget register that this was funded, and still nothing has happened. So there's different feedback loops.
We have some new community board members, so and I know I'll turn to you guys, but is everybody familiar with the district service cabinet?
No. I don't know what that is.
Someone explain the district service cabinet? Yes.
District service cabinet is a meeting held monthly by the district manager of a community board, sometimes with her staff, and with the leaders of the uniformed services that serve the district. So that's the police, the fire, and sanitation. Often the Department of Transportation and the Department of Buildings will also take part, and the purpose of it is to do a variety of coordinating matters and to check in on exactly what you're talking about. In my district, in the Upper West Side, for example, there'll be one devoted entirely to the marathon with the outflow of the runners and so forth. There'll be another that is a monthly check-in on issues about repaving and so forth, because there's a cycle to repaving of streets that DOT needs to coordinate with a variety of other city services. Among other things, if Con Ed wants to dig up your street, they're not supposed to do it within 6 months to a year of repaving. That's not a breach, but that is the rule. Anyway, that's the sort of thing. So the district service cabinet is a regularly scheduled monthly meeting at which the district manager can convey, keep her finger on the pulse of what's going on with all these agencies, and be a source or conduit for coordination for those agencies. Because one thing that you learn as a community board member really quickly is that agencies would rather eat glass than talk to each other. So this is a means to do that, and it works every month.
And you're allowed to sit in on it as a community board member, right? It's closed, it's not an open meeting, but.
I've never felt welcome, but.
You're never felt welcome, but I suspect this.
But if it's the open meeting, though, it's got to be open, right?
No, not this district. No, that's closed. Yeah, but community board members I've known, I've been invited. But I guess, like I said, all 12 community boards are different. But you should be able to. I don't think you will be told no.
There's a question here. Yeah.
Well, two questions. Yeah. Do most agencies have the flexibility to fund based on their own priorities? Probably like sanitation and all these other ones, to allocate funds the way they supposedly, theoretically, have an expertise. And part of that is to allocate the money they're given and spend it. I would say most agencies, do most of them end up spending most of the money in their budget?
Question. I would think that every agency...
The reason I'm asking is if that's the case, then isn't, from a community board standpoint, isn't it a good default setting that if you don't get something done, it was at a minimal, that agency's discretionary, that you know, they spent their funds, and for whatever reason, you didn't meet that threshold, and then one should just, rather than, it's almost like somebody not getting their phone calls returned from dating, at a certain point, you didn't get the date, you didn't get it done, then it's a political thing, isn't it?
No, absolutely. Yeah, and I mean,
you know, it shouldn't be hurt feelings.
The budget process is incredibly complicated. There's a lot of political considerations, and also what the gentleman back there said. The street might not have gotten fixed because there is work planned to rip out the sewer or something like that. So there's a lot of coordination being done. I mean, the golden rule of budgeting is there's never enough money. So something is not getting done. And what's important, where community input is important, to find out and effectively convey what are really the most important things in your district. I cannot promise you that the agencies will listen to that, but it's important to convey that to the agencies, and what we are working on is trying to make the agencies listen more closely to what the communities say and think that is most important in their district.
And the council members all have discretionary money.
Yes, yeah. So but
and that's what the agencies tell you. Go to your council members.
Mm-hmm. But
they don't have as much as the agencies.
Yeah.
Do.
But I mean, the city's budget is like 80 something billion dollars, and the discretionary budget of the council members is peanuts compared to that. That's a couple millions, and I mean. For us, a million is a lot of money, but that doesn't buy you a lot of stuff in like road repairs or new sewer lines or anything like that. So it's really the thing about the CD needs and budget requests is that it's very difficult to get the agencies to listen and to get involved in the process, but that's where the big bucks are spent and are available. And obviously the discretionary budget of a council member can help with some instances, but it's not a lot of money in the big scheme of things. Yeah?
So I have a question, and it's kind of a recommendation too, because I hear a lot of questions about like allocation of data, and I thought, like, is there any existing data management tool, whether it's like a database or any sort of like visual interactive application where you can see the data spread out by all the different community boards. So like you could go in and build an application or a database and put in all the factors for the different community boards and then have the data be released so that you can see a project name and the budget size and percentages spent to track spending for a specific budget as well as allocation to different community boards, so that way it's very clear which projects still have like remaining budget that can be used, or like if you know, to increase the utilization for the budget.
Yeah, and we're working on it, but we tried last year, 2 years ago, we tried to map the city's capital budget. And we could map a significant part of it, but not all of it. Part of it had to do with us not getting good information from city agencies. But the other thing is that not everything is mappable. So, for example, where do you map the new sludge boat from the Department of Environmental Protection? Or what we saw was, we saw this huge ball of money, so we had like little circles that showed how much money was spent in certain locations. We saw this huge dot in the middle of Queens. And we're like, holy cow, what's going on in Queens? And it turns out it was the DEP headquarters. And what was budgeted to this specific site was all the money that goes to the reservoirs in upstate New York. And that's oftentimes the problem with the budget, that it's very complex information. There's very different levels of information, and things get folded up in the budget process. And how can it be untangled that community boards understand what was actually funded in their districts and whatnot? And our suspicion at the moment is that probably more stuff gets funded than people think, but it's not easy to convey that. And at the moment, it's just a suspicion. We have to do our homework. Yeah? Yeah, I mean, there's, yeah.
Same thing with, like, the tugboats or what have you, so that where it formally sits, because that's really a resource that the people are paying for, but they really don't know where it's at.
Mm-hmm.
And I think mapping shows where things actually live.
Mm-hmm.
And the money doesn't live with the DEP in Queens, it lives for the people in the reservoirs and in the sludge boats. I just want to share that.
No, of course, and yeah, and we're trying to make that information better, but that also means that it's information that needs to be conveyed to the agencies and back and forth. And then there's other things that the city might update a data center in downtown Manhattan, but it makes service deliveries at a field office in Brooklyn more efficient. So where do you map that? Do you put a huge dot at the data center in downtown Manhattan, or how do you account for the efficiency gains in other places? So there's a couple of things. You can make the maps better by asking agencies to provide better information. And then there are some things that simply are not very easy to map. And I think one of the things, like now with Google Maps and so on, we think that everything can be mapped, but maybe not. And we are also at the very beginning of some of those things, and it needs time for those things to develop. But a couple of things that city planning is actively working on is trying to map where the city is investing money and make that available to the public. But those are also huge. It's so many data sets. We tried a couple of things, and then the computer crashed because it's so many data sets that you can't really efficiently show on a map that it has any purpose. Yeah.
So I'm a new community board member, and I'm just getting a little lost. Isn't it the community board? I mean, there's so much information at a certain point. It's almost like there's too much information. There's too many colored maps. And and at a certain point, some of it's not important because each of us are on a community board.
Yeah.
I'm just trying to understand this myself. Yeah. And we know what was asked for, and we know what was funded and what wasn't. And isn't it better to simplify to say the stuff that wasn't funded for that community board? Really, all you can do, you can spend all your time looking at the rest of the city, all the other maps, all the other community boards, but ultimately, it's about the community board you're in, looking at what wasn't funded, and all you really can do is spend your time with your councilmen and some other people in that district to go after the money that wasn't funded. Isn't it better to spend the time there than looking at all this information where you may not even be able to do anything about it?
I mean, first of all, you have to provide it for all community districts so that they all individually could do that kind of analysis. So we, as a city, we have to provide it for 59 community districts. But one of the things that we're trying to do with the community portal is giving you, and this is why also I and we are asking for your feedback, what is the information that is would be really useful for you on a community district level, and some things we can do relatively easily, some things that we heard from you, like the whole thing, like how much money is the city investing in my district? How much money does the Parks Department put in my district? How much money does the Sanitation Department put in my district? This is something that, that we heard, that we're working on, but that's a bigger lift and that will time to implement. And then, of course, it also relates to what does it really mean? Like, if the city invests a lot of money in one specific district, it might just mean that before there was nothing, and another district where they invest only a little money, there might already be sufficient facilities of that specific type. So it also has to be contextualized to a certain degree, and this is where it becomes complicated, and this is what we are working on. Yeah.
Could it ever mean that that community board is presenting a better planning proposal? Because it's guided by the planning proposal submitted to the agencies. So it might be that some community boards are submitting more complete planning proposals. So perhaps the secret is in asking.
Yeah.
So the more you
absolutely.
Ask, the better you ask, the more you get.
No, I mean, one thing that we also seen, and that was another motivation for us to look at the process, is that we've seen Manhattan boards are very good. They prepared very well-developed community district need statements. Unfortunately, there were like 20... or even more community districts that did not submit anything at all. And the thing with the new form was that we actually had 55 out of 59. That's like an all-time record for CD needs statements. And at the same time, we wanted to make sure that the quality improves of all those. So we don't want this to be a race to the bottom. We want to generally lift the level of community board participation in the budget process. Yeah?
So one of the frustrations of that is that ours is one of the boards that had a 50-page document that had integrated a number of different threads so that, for example, a park or a playground could impact youth, impact education, it could impact active recreation, a number of different community needs, and the new form required us to filter it into one of those boxes and then generate district needs that go against that category, which often didn't actually correlate to the agency whose budget we're trying to impact.
Yeah.
And then there's the whole notion of having a narrative statement that gives context and continuity to the series of the evolution of the problem over time, none of which could be filtered into the actual drop-down menus. At best, we were trying to cut and paste it and often butcher it because there's only so many characters you can put into the box. So it's quite frustrating to try to continue a useful English language process that can result in not just, the agencies always say no. They always say ask a council member, and it's not just the council member memorized, by the way. It's also council-wide restorations. The best example is the public library system. They are constantly underfunded by about $40 million, give or take, and it's, even though this mayor has said that they're going to end the budget dance, here we go around again, that every year they put the money back, but only for that year. Trying to make sure that ends up in the right place on our district needs statement is actually not a simple task under the new process, whereas under youth education and libraries, we had a really robust discussion of not only what the library needs, but the interrelationship between the library, senior citizens, and children, so that you can actually get a good advocacy position together. Yeah. And that's one of the frustrations of the new thing. We haven't seen this year's iteration, but last year's iteration, I guess I'm timed out.
I mean, one thing that we did is we give you much more space to provide that information. So that is one of the changes that we made, and there's a lot of feedback like that we heard and that we tried to incorporate.
Can I offer just one more thing? Mm-hmm. One of the things you mentioned earlier strike me as something that would not be a goal, and that is you're talking about the ability to my word not yours, track trends across different community districts, both within our borough and those other boroughs. And the thing that I'm thinking about is that the whole notion of a community board, and especially the notion of a district needs statement, is that we should be expressing the needs of our district. Mm-hmm. And whether or not it correlates to something that is also in need, either across the park or across the river, is not only irrelevant, but actually contrary to the point. The whole idea is that what we should be offering to the budget process is the unique perspective that doesn't get, my word, homogenized, but it doesn't lend, the unique voice is what we absolutely need to be hearing, and to the extent that we are building systems that try to aggregate needs will by definition leave behind the unique needs that ought to be the province of the folks in this room.
No, absolutely, and this is your contribution to the process, is exactly that unique perspective that you can provide. At the same time, the commissioner of the Department of Environmental Protection looks at a whole city, and the difficult task is then to somehow get those two things together. But I think you're absolutely right. It's absolutely vital that we get from you the best information possible to impact that process. It's then for us as planners, either at city planning or the different city agencies, to evaluate that information and to say, this community district in Manhattan is in a unique position because of A, B, and C, and therefore we think it makes sense to invest this money or not invest this money. Yeah?
I would like to respond to your comment. I agree with the idea, I agree with you, absolutely, that every community neighborhood is unique and that each neighborhood does have its own strengths and weaknesses. I also like the idea that the department is looking for trends because it can help inform a larger discussion, be it about housing, be it about healthcare, be it about lack of public facilities, that if 19 out of 25 community boards highlight a particular topic somewhere near the top of the priority list, it can clue in, hopefully, the political arms, yeah, to understand that there is a citywide problem. So I think I agree with both of you, if I may.
Yeah?
Do the individual departments do their own, like, our community needs as well? I'm a health planner, so when I look at, I know the state does, and they cooperate with the department with mental health and hygiene. Mm-hmm. I work particularly with Communicable, so I can look through people's zip codes and find out what hospital they're in and what they were discharged, where they were discharged from, and what they were discharged with.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know their name, but I know where the concentrations are. And they do the same thing with other community issues that the community boards are paying attention to as well, if not in the least.
I mean, the health department is very active in that, and I mean, I think at the moment we're also a little bit as at like a crossroads. So there is this whole discussion about big data and all that data becoming available, and we're producing all the data. Part of the question is, what are we doing with it, and how can we use it? And I think at the moment, not just the city is trying to figure out how we can use that data efficiently. And what also has happened is that every agency now starts collecting their own data, and how does it really go together, and how can it be coordinated? That is a very important task that currently we're working on. And how, for example, can health data be used for land use planning? What's the relationship between the two things, and how can we create a useful relationship between those two data sets? And what I mentioned before about mapping the capital budget is something that we can do a lot of stuff, but why are we doing it? And what's coming out of it? And what's the best format that's most useful for different audiences? This is still something I think that's very much evolving. Yeah?
Well, just even what you were saying is, with the community boards, not to lose sight of that we can provide the specifics, like you're saying, from our particular neighborhood. So you have, say you have, like she said, 19 out of 20 community boards have this issue. But still, even though there's 19 out of those 20, there's still specifics within those 19. So why not have a place where we can upload our specifics in our document so that we can support, so you don't lose that. Like you're saying, it's like you can't take this, I mean, you can maybe shrink it, but you can't put it in a little box.
I mean,
even if it's like, say you give us 500 words, or you give us 3,000 words, basically, why kill yourselves, or kill us? Just say, we can give you a paragraph, even a page of what's going on, but look, here's our supportive document so that you can download that.
You can upload supportive documents, and there's no limitation whatsoever what you can upload. And we are also making a difference this year. You could do that last year as well. But there will be a place where you can upload images that will show up in the CD need statements, like graphs and so on, tables, or just images. Like, this is the huge pothole in my street that I want you to deal with. But there will also be a place where you can upload reports and other documents that will be linked to that document.
Those are going to be your links, like you're saying, how to connect this and that. You know, because it's not always for everybody to see the bigger picture, because that may not be their expertise or their experience or whatever, just their mindset, period.
Yeah.
So if other people are doing the work for you, use that.
Yeah, no, absolutely, and we encourage that. We want to empower all community districts. We want to be able to present the same level of detail and the same level of information, but one community district might simply not have a problem. So. And another community district might have very severe problems in a particular policy area, and we want you to express those needs.
We're going to 8.
Yeah. Maybe
you see
slides there's two more things I want to briefly mention, but maybe we can take this question first.
No, on the topic of how the different sections and the different committees basically respond to the different sections. For our community board, it kind of worked in our favor because we had an issue about a developer taking back some an easement in a public space, and there was quite a battle on our land use committee. And the developer won, but in the section for education and schools, they clearly stated that they needed more open space for the kids, and the buildings that were being built around the school as part of the deal to get the school built made it so dark for the children that they don't have daylight, no sunlight to go and play in.
in a schoolyard. So the fact that it was so compartmentalized that one committee looked at this and said, we have control, 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 and another committee did their thing. It's, there's a written record that shows in our community board, we needed to protect our open space, and we did not. So, like on in that debate, you know, because the right hand didn't the super control didn't get to edit the whole thing. There wasn't enough time because there's so many pieces. Maybe it didn't mean to work out that way, but it there is a written record of that conflict now with our community board and representing the kids in our district.
And I mean, obviously, last year there was also very little time to prepare the whole thing.
It was
thing.
Very late. You yes. changed the process yes. very late in
yeah.
the year.
Yeah.
Is that the same for this year?
No. We will. It will be the new form will be out like early next week. So there's much more time. And the thing is also it's
about what 2 months before.
Yeah.
2 months earlier last year.
Yeah.
Or a month earlier?
At least a month earlier. Sorry. And the other thing is it's pre-populated with what you put in last year.
Oh, that's helpful.
So you don't have to cut and paste the whole thing all over again. You edit what you provided last year. And as I said, there is more space for narrative. So the beginning, there's a very big narrative in the beginning. We gave, we allow for more space, and then for each policy section, we doubled, I think at least doubled, the character limits. And those narratives are very important to make exactly those connections. When you write about public safety, that you also say, well, this is not just a policing issue, this is also a youth and education issue, and therefore, we made those budget requests for more after-school programs and so on. Yeah.
But just to that point, if to the extent that you are trying to track trends, and Community Board 7 decides that a playground issue is a youth issue, and Community Board 8 tracks it as an education issue, and somebody else tracks it as an open space land use issue, will you be able to integrate that as a trend and identify it as a trend if each of us pulls down a different menu? Certainly the descriptive explanation can touch on all of those things. One of the vices of subject matter categorization is it's all in the hands of the guy who's got his finger on the keyboard.
No, of course. I mean, one thing is that it's much easier with the new system to aggregate if we know, for example, that out of the 59 or 55 community boards that submitted, 27 selected affordable housing as one of the main issues in their district, which was very surprising for us because it's actually less than half the community districts that say affordable housing is a top three issue. What we then saw, and I think that goes in the direction what you're just saying, is that when we looked closer, and this is why it's very important for you to provide explanations for that selection, is that there are different explanations for the lack of affordable housing. So in some instances, it was a lack of housing. Period. In some instances, it was a lack of, there's overall enough housing, but there's a lack of housing at a specific price point. And that is something that we looked into by looking at all the explanations that community boards provided. I think there's justification in both having sort of the big header. 27 community boards say affordable housing is a problem, but also having the ability to then really dive deeper, and that was actually what we did for Manhattan. We really found the difference between like North Manhattan and South Manhattan, where in Southern Manhattan it was there is no housing, period, and in Northern Manhattan was yeah there's housing but we can't afford it. And that is why we don't just want the drop-down menus and the radio buttons. because this is really sort of the richness that you as the community boards can provide to the discussion and that we looked at very carefully. Yeah?
I apologize if this was answered already, but in the collection of all of these district needs statements that are done electronically now, is there something as simple on your end as a keyword search, like housing, so that if it doesn't show up in the top level, but it shows up in another place that we were just describing, if you were looking for which community boards identified it as a key issue, but not necessarily under that top heading, is that something that is technically available?
I mean, a keyword search is not a big problem, technologically speaking. I mean, it's really also just a way of, like, we have like 2.5 people working on this, and you have, 55 community boards submitted a CD need statement. So let's say every community board produced like 20 pages of information. That is a whole lot of information to sift through for 2.5 people. And that's also where it becomes very important that the information is structured to a certain extent. That when you look at housing, you make sure that you find housing relevant stuff in the housing section and not somewhere else. And that was also the problem that city agencies had before. They got a book with 59 community district need statements. And for the Department of Transportation, every community district might have had a page about DOT stuff, potholes and so on. But that guy or girl who had to go through all those 59 community district need statements had no idea of where to find the information that is relevant to DOT. So when in doubt, they didn't read it. What we want to do is we want to make it more difficult for them not to read it. And this is something we're working on, and as a parallel process that's going on is that we are reaching out to city agencies, and we're trying to get in touch with the people. We try to figure out who read the thing in the past and who didn't read it in the past. How can we get more people to read it? The thing is also, like, agencies are huge. So there is this one guy who's responsible for answering community district need statements. That's some, like, budget dude somewhere who has no idea what the planning division of that same department might be doing. So what we're trying to do is get the budget people, the planning people, the intergovernmental affairs people together and tell them, look, there's this new product that we have that might be really useful for you, because when you go to the next community meeting, you might not get attacked for not listening to their district needs because you didn't know there were those specific district needs. But as I said, this is a process that will take a long time, because we have 59 very different community boards, and we have 300 very different agencies, and they all work differently, and we're trying to figure out how to best plug that information in their different processes, and that will take some time, and it will take a lot of patience on your end, on our end, on the agency's end, but hopefully it will make the process overall more productive for everyone involved, so that you don't feel like we make those requests and they end up in this like black hole and we get stupid responses back. And the agencies say, we have no idea what they're talking about, this request doesn't make any sense to us. And this is what we're trying to solve, and it's a big one. Yeah.
So I'm an intern, a community planning intern here in Manhattan, and I know a lot of the other interns, including myself, would really love
to process some type of big data project.
Mm-hmm.
I can't speak for all the interns, but I know it's of great interest. So I can make a suggestion that there somehow be a partnership with the Manhattan Borough President's Office for all 12 of the community board's interests to be represented and maybe put into the format that would be guided by a partnership with your department. Mm-hmm. I think a lot of interns would really enjoy that.
Mm-hmm.
Just to offer from the ground, really below, of people who are doing grunt work who really enjoy working with data.
Yeah. I can definitely reach out to Aldrin and see what we can do. Believe me, our interns at City Planning, they do more with data than they probably ever wished for. but maybe there's a way to sort of cross to have some sort of cross training and interaction there.
We can have more than two and a half people.
Yeah. And I mean the other thing is also that there will be more training available for the CD Needs Forum as well coming in June. We're currently organizing that with the various borough presidents, and I think Sarah actually sent you an email today about scheduling that. So We are open to also include other aspects in the training that maybe go a little bit beyond that form itself to allow you to get better information to populate that form. Okay. Not quite through the presentation. One thing that I wanted to mention is Zola. Has anyone used that application before? So
at the end, we have a workshop called Open Data Resource Drive at the end of this month, and part of we're going to go through 5 or 6 databases in real detail. But this is one of the ones that you'll be able to.
So this is really, and I mean, we don't have the time to go too much into detail, but this is really more an invitation of like checking it out, because there's a lot of stuff in it that you can look into. So Zola is a mapping tool that is mostly relevant for land use and zoning. But what you can do here is you can look for a specific address. And it identifies the particular address, and then it gives you all kinds of information about that particular property here. So it tells you something about the zoning. If you don't know what on earth C5-5 means, you can click here and it actually provides you with an information with some of the basic zoning for that particular district. It tells you where you can find it on the zoning map if it's in a special district. But what you can also find is building and property information. When was the building built? Is it landmarked or is it not? How many square feet does this particular building have? Who's the building owner? In many instances, that's not particularly useful because it's some LLC, but it gives you a first indication of what's going on. And the other thing that you can do is you can overlay all kinds of information on that particular map. So for example, so here's the property, 120 Broadway.
Well, we're not seeing that.
Sorry?
We're not seeing that.
Oh, you're not seeing it? There. I'm not quite sure what's happening here, but. Okay, so this is the building we talk about, so you can search here by location. And then you can overlay additional information here. So for example, I clicked here, the zoning. So this shows you the zoning boundaries in Lower Manhattan. So this is the C455 district. Those are the neighboring zoning districts and so on. You can also show so we talked about the environmental restrictions before. You can see those as well, if there are any in that particular area. You probably have to, usually they get imposed on, when there is a rezoning, they establish those restrictions. And it tells you the number, and then you can look it up in the zoning resolution what that particular environmental restriction entails. So is it like hazmat testing, or sometimes there is restrictions on what heating fuels you can use for a new development, and so on.
So with the zoning resolution, one of the drop-down boxes, how are you navigating that?
The zoning resolution you can find here under zoning,
okay.
And here's the zoning text. And if you're interested in the environmental restrictions, you would go here to this table. And then the other thing that I mentioned is the restrictive declaration. So this is a subset of deed restrictions on properties. It does not have everything, it has some of those deed restrictions. But what you can see here, if this thing opens, it gives you it tells you to which lots this restriction applies, and it gives you a very short information what kind of restriction it is. So it says hazmat, and you can find more information about the restriction when you go to the CPC report, because then it quotes and refers to the environmental review that was done, and it then explains in detail what kind of testing would have to be done on that particular property. So, and with the restrictive declarations here, the same thing. So they are marked on the map, and when you look up the CPC report, it would then explain what kind of restriction is imposed on that particular property. So the important thing is here that the report number that allows you to access the CPC report that explains in detail what restrictions there are on a particular piece of property. But obviously this is also only restrictions that were imposed by the city. This is not any private covenants between property owners and so on.
And that information is up to date as well?
Yes. So the zoning resolution, the online version is actually the most up-to-date version of zoning that is available. There's still a printed version, but obviously it takes time for those updates to be printed. And the CPC reports, they get published as soon as the City Planning Commission votes on it. It gets published on the website. So within a couple of days after the vote or final approval and adoption through the City Council, it gets posted online. Any other questions? Yeah?
Do we have access to other community board district need statements?
They're all on the website, so you can read all 55 of them.
On your website?
Yeah.
Okay.
So you just pick a district, and once again, Ford chose not to submit, so they are missing, but then it will say this board did not submit CD need statements. But all Manhattan boards submitted, all of Queens, Brooklyn were the
the ones. The government hand boards also have it in their own individual community
yeah.
board
yeah.
websites.
Yeah.
That's
right. Yeah.
Which is really important because a lot of foundations, I'm sure mm-hmm. you know this, a lot of foundations reference your district needs mm-hmm. statements when they want to provide funding mm-hmm. to some of the nonprofits in your neighborhoods to see if the problems identified in their grant proposals mirror much mm-hmm. of the problems that you've identified through a group process mm-hmm. in your statement of district needs. So it's a document that's used just not by government agencies, but private foundations and just foundations that are in the grant-making business.
Yeah, and that's also very important information that we learned through the feedback sessions that we had in all five boroughs, was that we approached it as a budget document, but what we learned from you that a CD needs statement is used for so much more, so we want to work with you to make the CD needs statement better to also be useful for those other purposes. So that's where your feedback is very important for us to further develop that particular product.
One thing we didn't talk about, we talked about in the budgets workshop in the role of the community board. If you haven't taken that workshop, there's one class left. Is I don't think you mentioned it, it might be my way, but it's the rural budget consultations.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Everybody familiar with the rural budget consultations? It's an important part of this as well, where generally is the district manager. And it happens in September and October, where you meet with the different city agencies. So it's all the district managers, although they do invite committee chairs, and I think you were one of them.
I've been to almost all of them for 6 years. They're actually an amazing opportunity to hear straight from the, a lot of the agencies send very senior level commissioners or deputy commissioners, and so it's a really amazing opportunity to hear straight from them what they think the budget is all about for them. And the district managers do a great job, but there's no reason why.
This year we want to open it up. We want to open it up more. So usually the commissioner, and this year the borough president, Gilbo, is going to send an email and a call. She'll call them. She wants to make sure commissioners show up with their deputy commissioner, so that's into the community boards. And we're also going to try to get, for the first time, and we're going to try to get this reform through OMB and DCP, is that two agencies that impact many of your residents that you would think would be there because your statement of district needs mentions problems with that, or things that could be done better, is the Department of Education, or the School Construction Authority, and NYCHA, both of which are not involved in budget consultations because they're not city agencies.
Oh.
The Department, while the mayor appoints the chancellor, the DOE is not a city agency, and NYCHA is not one. It's like a quasi. So this time, the borough president is going to reach out so that for the first time, we're going to hope to get the Department of Education and NYCHA, because much of what you're writing is statement of district needs, and much of what impacts your residents has to do with those two huge agencies. Mm-hmm. And the fact that they're not around the table and we cannot question them on what they're funding and how do they know, why do they fund what they're funding, and what kind of feedback loop is there, that conversation hasn't happened. So we're hoping to make it happen this time around. And we're optimistic, but it's not, like I said, they don't have to, they're independent agencies.
The Department of Education were the only agency that said top 10 on our district needs budget.
I mean, there's actually a couple of agencies that are almost offended that they aren't invited to, and a lot, I mean, Manhattan in many instances is very good, but I think it was the health department that only gets invited to two boroughs, and they were sort of confused as to why the other boroughs don't invite them. So it's a very important point that we want to work with everyone involved to get better representation at those meetings. There's also oftentimes a difference between Manhattan and the other boroughs, because I mean all the commissioners have their offices somewhere around here, but in the Bronx, for example, it's much harder to get good representation, so that's an issue we're trying to address. And the reason why the CD needs statements are due in August is to give the agencies an opportunity to read those CD needs statements and respond and have a discussion about the needs and hopefully get agreement that, yeah, we think you're right, this seems to be a problem here, so let us work together to find a solution for that. But obviously DOE, NYCHA, Transit Authority, those are all agencies that traditionally have not been there, but of course have a very important role in everyone's daily life.
Question. So does OMB make comments or review the these need statements and then give feedback maybe to the agencies if some of the issues have not been dealt with?
No.
Some
no.
major issues?
Yeah.
So OMB has no...
I mean, so what the agencies are required to do is give responses to the budget requests. Mm-hmm. They're not required to do anything with the CD need statements. They're not even required to read them. What we want the agencies to do is to pay closer attention because it has information that is potentially very important and very useful for them. And a big part of what we're doing right now is talking to the agencies and also talking to different people within the agencies. Like a lot of the planning people, they didn't know that this exists and this information exists, and they say, that's like great stuff that is very useful for us and our community outreach and our planning work to know this kind of information. So that is part of what we're doing, but there's no formal requirement for an agency to comment on the need statements. There's only a requirement to comment on the budget requests, and unfortunately the charter does not say that it has to be a good response. It just it has to be a response.
No, I understand that part, but OMB has no say, no review, no anything.
I mean, OMB also, honestly, they don't know. They can't really judge if that need a community formulates is...
OMB, they present in the budget one with the Royal Community Board. From what I recall, the gentleman from OMB saying is that they do have a role, right, in this one. I don't remember if we made it the whole role, but I know that it's part of some of the agency response where the agency says, good idea, but we don't have budget. OMB actually says that sometimes they're the ones that say, well, actually, you do have budget. And then they know what can be rescinded, what's been expensed out, what hasn't. So they do have a role in this whole budget process.
Yeah, it's for the budget requests, but not for the needs.
Yeah, I just have to say, you know, the borough president, at least the Manhattan borough president, is trying very hard to get people to participate and the commissioners to participate. But the one that controls all this is the mayor's office. And I think the mayor, we got to all push the mayor to take it very seriously. If he tells the agencies they have to participate and have to give better answers at least, and the same to OMB, he's their boss.
Yeah.
Another thing, we wanted the community boards, district managers together compile a list of questions beforehand. And the reason you do the district statement, district needs in like July and August, in order to get it to the agency by September, so that by end of September or October, agencies could have time to read it and digest it and get back to us. Community district managers give them a series of questions. And in the past, when I've attended these borough consultations, the commissioners show up without... we ask them to give us answers prior so that we don't discuss what's already been answered. And many of them come with no handouts, no answers, and they just...
They come because they think they have to.
They don't come like really prepared. And that's one thing that we're trying to change by letting them know ahead of time. We want the answers provided to us ahead of time, because if there's some things we don't have to discuss, we can discuss the issues that are more important, because, you know, so, and we hope that we'll get responses from them beforehand, but there's no guarantees.
So you have a few of your trainings that are already closed out?
Oh yeah, I know everybody's been asking about that. I'm gonna open up, I think parliamentary procedure is gonna open up with 10 more slots, and I think resolution writing might be opening up with 10 more slots. And conflict of interest, even if it's full, since it's required for you to attend, you know, once I think every 2 years, just come to that one, even if you're not able to register. The conflict of interest, freedom of information. Then that's one on Monday.
It's Monday and the 20th.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
build the PowerPoint, so you should all have the PowerPoint ready?
Yes.
Thank you so much.
You did a great job.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, it was very easy. You did a great job.
I just have a question. Thank you very much. Is the community boards are part of the
uniform land use review procedure?
Uniform land
use review procedure.
It's the first time I receive an invitation, but for 8 years I am on the community advisory board.
Yeah.
But I never received an invitation to this last.
Yeah.
I didn't know this.
Yeah.
And now I'm planning to go to my community board, actually, because I'm due, you see. I have 1 more year to go.
I'll see you later.
And I said, now, because I go to meetings, but I don't want to get too much into my
head. Yeah. Yeah, no, absolutely. Yeah, thank you.
Oh, thank you. How are you in the town? 232 Park. I'm going that way. Yeah. How are you? Which one you can take? See you all.
Hey, John, congratulations.
Oh, thank you. And that guy Alex Kim was part of the presentation, and he's very entertaining. So he's the guy that goes, hey, without it all.
Yeah, no, that's good.
Thank God. Right. Something I actually use. Thanks.
Which
one
did you look? Oh, I will, absolutely.
Yeah, sure.
That's where you have a
Based on what you said, I was saying you could go ahead and the reception going to 9. And then if it goes to 9, are you okay? Push information now sorted by CV, because who can look through all that stuff and none of it doesn't pertain to you.
But that, I got to look through it in my hands.
But the Dance Theater of Harlem, was it, or the public notice showed up. Who reads that stuff? And they just do it there. We actually have some legislation that Gail's trying to push. Community choice, your jewel. You'd be like, I'm gonna sell it. I'm gonna just put it here.
What is DCAS? What is that man doing?
The commissioner of DCAS now, she's been there for 3 months. So the other commissioner,
he skipped out.
Stacey Cumberbatch, the mayor transferred her, and I think it was related to this whole stuff.
Yeah, but what is he? What is he doing? How crazy is that?
It's crazy. But the thing is, this is opening up a can of worms, because we're just sitting there, we're selling the city left and right.
Yes.
We're selling all, everything is taken. Yes. We thought on the Bloomberg did a lot to sell everything, but the Blasio's.
But I'm saying that he's following right behind.
He does so much that I like that I'm doing, but this particular aspect of, closing up to all these different realistic lobbyists and everything.
Yeah.
It's just.
Yeah. Just like what people were saying when they were mentioning the health care and things, like, okay, right now I'm facing 3 layoffs, 2 sales, and I don't believe in coincidences, but I got the same, like they were like, oh, it's so because they're Jewish. I said, don't give me that crap. Even, you don't have the same, it's not a coincidence, if you have the same attorney that is buying, that the people you represent are buying the nursing home in the Bronx, Jewish home, and you're buying Beth Abraham from Central Life, bullshit. And then now you're getting ready to violate. Unfortunately, we don't have good staffing, we don't have any staffing laws. California's only state that has them, but you're getting ready to staff with LPNs, and you'll just shut the LPNs. But they have a scope of practice with the delegation. And I said to them, what happens if a patient goes south at night, and I don't mean to Florida.